everybody. Welcome to this podcast.
Hello. My name's Sam, and this is Alex.
Yes, we will be doing general gaming podcasts here and there, here on and off. If you are on Sam's channel, you already know who Sam is. If you're on my channel, you already know who I am.
Indeed.
So, let's get down to the meat of it. As you should tell by the intro, this week we're talking about the GameCube.
Yep. Anyway, also, as far as this recording started, we probably don't have, like, a full-on name for the podcast yet.
Yeah. So let's just call that as Alex and Sam's podcast, shall we?
Yeah, until we get something better, and pretty much... Alex, do you want to say anything else, like any handles you go by online? Or...
Well, my YouTube channel is always called Camcorder Playthroughs, who's unless it's not.
Okay. And then I pretty much go by GamerSan pretty much anywhere. Sometimes Spaghetti Man.
I've got the link to my website down in the description below here. So, let's talk about the GameCube. Nice little system. Second most powerful next to the Xbox. Didn't have a hard drive, but neither did the Dreamcast.
Yeah, pretty much the GameCube, if you count, like, since the Dreamcast pretty much didn't do too good and pretty much was faded out, like, pretty much around the time the GameCube actually came out and, like, hit it big... Like, if you count the GameCube amongst its two biggest rivals, the PS2 and the Xbox, it pretty much did the pretty low as far as it goes in North America. It was never really, like, a terrible failure, but as far as Nintendo standards was, it was definitely a failure.
I wouldn't exactly say that. I don't really judge it on how well a console sells, more like...
I'm talking mostly market-wise.
Oh, yeah. Not retrospectively, of course.
If we're talking retrospectively,
yeah, the Dreamcast would be the number one console of all time.
Yeah. But anyway, pretty much the GameCube had a lot of things going for it, but then a lot of things that weren't, and then there was issues with Nintendo... like there had been with the N64, kind of continuing over.
Well, what precisely are you talking about, issues with Nintendo?
Like, there's some issues. Some people that were, used to be, like, full-on Nintendo pretty much left.
Oh, yeah, that went
to, the N64 because of Nintendo's, policies.
What Nintendo policies? He's like, the cartridges?
That was part of it. There was also things like all the agreements you had to do to be a Nintendo licensee.
All of those stopped about the Super Nintendo, about the time the Super Nintendo came around.
Well, there were still some of them going on, and then pretty much a lot of people felt burned. They switched over during Sony during that time and whatnot. Of course, Microsoft wasn't there at all. Sega, as far as North America goes, was struggling with the Saturn a bit, and Sega was struggling even back then.
Yeah, so, the Saturn... we're not talking about the Saturn specifically, but it... like, you had to have a RAM cartridge, sort of like the N64, to play certain games and stuff.
Yeah.
It's like a 32-bit CD-based N64. I guess
you could say that. But anyway, going back to the GameCube, pretty much that thing, like, some people still found it odd that Nintendo still has, like, proprietary sets for, like, their games.
Like,
using disc base. Like, the GameCube disc was, like, a...
mini disc, yeah.
A mini disc, but it wasn't just a mini disc. It was slightly based off DVDs, and if I recall correctly, it runs
backwards. Yeah.
And the Nintendo system games still spin in reverse, pretty much.
Yeah. Something a lot of people are saying is that the 3DS is like a portable GameCube with its with its power.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, the DS was pretty much a portable N64, so...
Yeah, even though it was 32-bit.
Growth-wise.
Because you got games like Resident Evil 1, well, they call it Resident Evil Deadly Silence, Super Mario 64, or those kind of ports.
Yeah, they're almost direct ports in a way.
Yeah. Except that Super Mario 64 has better graphics than the N64 version.
I remember seeing some of the trailers and stuff about the GameCube and wanting one.
Yeah. I didn't get a GameCube until, like, after the Wii came out. Like, several years after the Wii came out. It was a Christmas present from my grandma. She didn't play it anymore. She gave me that and three games, Legend of Zelda, Wind Waker, Zelda Collector's Edition, and she was going to give me Enter the Matrix, but she couldn't find that. She also had this one thing.
I got mine as a Christmas gift. I can't remember the year properly.
Yeah. Same.
And the first game I got was a terrible mistake by my mother. She got me a Scooby-Doo game for it.
Ooh.
And I'm like, I don't know. But then after that, I traded in and I got Star Fox Adventures, and I tried really hard to enjoy and beat that game.
It's like a Zelda clone, right? Because I haven't played it.
For people that don't know, Star Fox Adventures was not originally at all a Star Fox game.
Yeah, it was this game called Dinosaur Island, Dinosaor Planet, I think.
And Dinosaur Creative, Planet, I recall.
Yeah, it was the last game made by Rareware before they got sold to Microsoft and completely died.
Basically, it was some scrapped scrapped N64 game stuff that was transitioned to the GameCube, and they decided we have Fox in it. So, I think that's partially one of the reasons that I was like, because it was a Zelda clone that wasn't as good. It had some, like, the story just kind of acts, like, terrible, because you're pretty much sticking Fox into something that's not Fox.
Yeah, because Fox is flying.
Here's some spoiler alerts. Well, even if that, he doesn't use his gun or anything, and the combat is just, like, Zelda-based.
Like, you press B to attack.
Yeah. But anyway, and then, a spoiler, we're gonna go into the ending. Do you remember the ending at all, Alex?
I already said I didn't play it.
Oh. Well, the ending's really terrible, pretty much. It pretty much goes where you play through, you collect all the spirit thingies that were captured, and then they just turn out that they form and they're Andross all along, which makes no sense. So you go through all these trials to help these things that are captured for some reason. They have to prove that you're worthy to save them.
Oh, man.
You go through all this trouble, you defeat the evil general, restore them, release Crystal, and they were all Andross all the time, which makes no sense at all. How Andross is some ancient relics on a planet for like a billion years. And then you fight him in space, and it's a really generic version of the N64 game, pretty much, and not near as fun. Until he kind of beats you, and then Falco just appears and does something, and then pretty much helps you. And then you defeat Andross again, and Crystal joins your thing, and the game pretty much ends like that. So, it was... Yeah. For anybody out there, you're not really missing much.
Yeah, because I played the original Super Nintendo Star Fox. I played Star Fox 64 and the one on the DS. I liked all three of them, but I kind of like Rogue Squadron better because of the free-roaming element, not the rail shooter. Hers the entire thing. But speaking of Rogue Squadron, and looking at the North American launch titles, you got All-Star Baseball 02, never heard of it. Batman Vengeance, did see an ad for that. I never played it. Crazy Taxi, that's a port of a Dreamcast game, right?
Yeah, I believe. Well, that was an arcade game, but the difference between the Dreamcast and arcade versions is usually barely anything because
the Sega Naomi.
Because their hardware is pretty much very similar from what they used at those times, so...
Luigi's Mansion, Tarzan Untamed.
I didn't get to play much of Luigi's Mansion at all near launch, but I eventually got it when it was at some, there was a game chain called Game Crazy, which they were a sub-chain of Hollywood Video as a rental store.
Oh, yeah, Hollywood Video went out of business, didn't they?
And they went out of business, and during that, I snagged a copy so I could finally play it all the way through.
Huh.
And I did, and I thought that was a really good... Luigi's Mansion was pretty much a solid game when it came out as open for the GameCube, but, like, everybody just overlooked it, so it's like...
Yeah. The rest of these things, it sounds pretty good. Luigi's Mansion Dark Moon Splatoon sounds like a pretty good game too. You know, you got a couple of EA sports games on, you know, they come out every year. They're the same thing. You played any of them, you know what they are, man. NFL 02, NHL 20.
I never really tried the Wave Race for the GameCube, though. I played the N64 one a bit, but...
Wave Race, Blue Storm, yeah. What's it about, anyways?
Wave Race is just pretty much a game where you go around and you pretty much race jet skis through the water. There's not much really more about it.
Oh, yeah, I played a PC game, and that sounds similar to that. Speaking of Star Wars and Rogue Squadron, Rogue Squadron 2, Rogue Leader. Yeah, I have been meaning to pick this game up.
I have yet to really play much of it myself. I rented it, but I never actually got a copy, but it was still pretty solid. That, the Star Wars Rogue Squadron series is probably one of the most solid Star Wars games.
Yeah, I've got the first game for the N64, and it's awesome. I had to put in a cheat code to unlock infinite health and all the enemies to beat it the first time. All the ships to beat it the first time, though.
I think at one point I might have 100% of that game, but I cannot recall. And the copy I had of it is no longer with me.
Oh.
So, but yeah, let's look through the launch titles.
That's a decent launch lineup. I've got Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3. No, I've got Pro Skater 2 for the Xbox. I never played it. Because I got a whole bunch of Xbox games. I have yet to play most of them.
Yeah. I'm trying to think. I didn't really play much of the Tony Hawk's Pro Skater 3 because it was during the transition period. So
yeah,
there was the current gen ones and then the previous gen ones. I played some of the PlayStation version, but there's a bit of differences.
Yeah. They don't even tell you what what Tarzan Untamed is. Is they just link you to the.
Yeah, I don't think we really need to bother too much with Disney or.
Ugh. It doesn't look like the Game Boy Advance version, and all the Game Boy Color version was like, ugh. I've got a whole bunch of Nintendo Powers. I was reading through that, and you cannot attack. It's a platformer, or it's not. It's a generic platformer with Tarzan branding. I think that is it. Super Monkey Ball. Batman Vengeance. Super Monkey Ball. Well, I've actually played Super Monkey Ball in a demo unit in Walmart back when the GameCube was still new. Oh, seriously. It came out for the N-Gage in Japan. The Electric Taco. Yeah, I actually can say that this is pretty good. Because yeah. I like it.
I don't know. I thought the N-Gage was kind of interesting when it came out, but of course it was a failed.
Well, I was talking about Super Monkey Ball, but yeah, the N-Gage was an interesting idea. It was like a smartphone before there were smartphones. But, yeah. You had to remove the battery to put a game in.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Did you know anybody that owned one? I didn't. I don't even know anybody that owns one now for retro purposes.
No, I've got... There was actually a Call of Duty game on the N-Gage a while back. About the time that they were still in the World War II period, not the Modern Warfare.
Yeah, there was... I'm pretty sure the N-Gage had a small thing, but we're getting kind of off topic.
Kind of off topic here. Batman Vengeance... is a Batman the Animated Series game. It's got a big picture of, well, Animated Series Batman on the cover. Are you on the Wikipedia page for it?
Yeah, I'm trying to think. Let me look at that. I'm trying to remember if that was considered a good one or not, because...
It sounds like Metal Gear Solid.
I think
Batman
I might remember seeing that on X-Play. Do you remember X-Play at all?
No, not really.
X-Play was this, it was back in the days of... Hold on.
X-Play, was this like a...
It was a TV show on Tech TV. It started out as Extended Play, then they changed to X-Play, and then when they were bought up by G4, it
was
X-Play.
Is that cable?
It was cable, yeah.
Yeah, we've never had cable. Well, we did have cable for a while in the late 90s, but... About 9/11 in time period, it then or maybe before we stopped having cable. So I never saw G4. I mean, I never saw X-Play, so... Let's see here.
Anyway,
Cinematic cutscenes, voice acting, story, first-person mode. Yeah, that sounds like Metal Gear Solid. Have you ever played it?
Which one?
Batman Vengeance.
I really can't remember if I have or not.
It's on the PS2. I gotta find that game. And I mean, I know we're talking about the GameCube here, but PS2 is where most... Like, I can find most games
Super
from
Monkey
the PS2.
Ball was another launch title, evidently, that I never got to really play much Super Monkey Ball until, like, a few years ago when I picked up a copy of Super Monkey Ball 2, but I enjoy the basics of Super Monkey Ball.
Right. Like I said, I played a little bit of it at a demo unit in Walmart, where I liked it, personally. And now we've got... Speaking of demo units in Walmart, I also played a demo of Super Mario Sunshine at, in Walmart one time. I really kind of like that. I saw a guy LPing it a while back. It's called The Only Chew Jelly. He shut down his channel a while ago. That actually made me want to play the game, because it was...
It looked fun.
Fun. Because, like, that's...
I enjoy it. It's only, it's kind of like, for me, it's just the fact that I never got around to playing it much then, and I'm busier now, and also, pretty much, I get stuck at some of the puzzles, and I feel like it's something that I need to, like, just do instead of, like, looking up online. Plus, there's only so much you can really...
Yeah.
Do looking up online to help solve for that kind of gameplay.
Yeah, that's the kind of thing, like, I don't have much love for Mario, because I literally played the hell out of the first, like, five games, I guess, world. Yeah, five games.
Pretty much every system game before that is what you're saying.
Yeah, so that's, like, that's really kind of cool, because I don't particularly care for Super Mario Galaxy, but I did because of the hub world was a little bit confusing, but I actually really like the Super Mario Sunshine, and because of the the jetpack.
Yeah, the Sunshine I definitely enjoyed playing. I never beat it 100%. That's one thing I kind of want to do. It's just compare it actually to like the previous Mario games. It's actually kind of difficult when you get further on. I don't know how far did you get in it? I got most of the levels unlocked, I guess, but I never got all of them. I got stuck on a few of those challenges where you had to go through those platforming things inside like weird areas.
Well, I played it about as much as I could on the demo back like 10 plus years ago, so I really can't tell. Don't remember. But I got to Gigantic Worm Boss.
I'm pretty sure I passed that.
Yeah. So you got stuff like sports games not selling very well on the PS, then not selling as well as they did on the PS2 and Xbox, but the sports games.
I can't recall the launch of the Xbox being that much better. I remember when the Xbox first came out, I didn't care for it because I didn't see anything I liked at first, but then that changed when I played Jet Set Radio Future, and I was like, that was what made me want it, so.
You know, speaking of, N64 remnants, Resident Evil Zero was originally a game for the N64, but they canceled it because it really pushed the N64 to the breaking point.
Yeah, pretty
so,
well.
And moved all the moved everything. They actually had it almost finished by the time that they made the GameCube version, and they essentially redid all the graphics and stuff, and to the point in which that it was a completely different game. They actually redid the plot too.
That kind of sounds reminiscent of Resident Evil 2's development itself. I don't know if you're aware of like Resident Evil 2 on the N64, how big of like a thing that was that they got that to work, because they basically
because they got it onto a single 512 megabyte cartridge.
Yeah, they took two PlayStation 1 discs and got it on there and got it working properly and added a few small things.
I remember the pre-rendered backgrounds on Ocarina of Time were like the kind of stuff that gives you headaches, you know? So were the backgrounds on par with the resolution of the PlayStation backgrounds? Because I only ever played the PlayStation.
I did not play it much, but as far as I know, it runs like pretty much just as good. The only issue is if you emulate it, there's issues with the backgrounds and stuff being all messed up because of how compressed it was.
And if you play the actual game, you got an issue with the joystick.
Yeah.
Let's see here. List of best-selling games. Smash Brothers Melee. Hey,
I don't think we have to say much about that game besides our own experiences, because I'm pretty sure many people have played that.
Oh man, I loved that game when I was playing it. It was like, I can't remember when I was playing it, but it was awesome. It was like as good as the original Super Smash Brothers, which after going back to that, I'm kind of disappointed that the original just had joystick support for jumping and stuff and moving around, because the joystick on my N64 is about ready to break. Mario Kart Double Dash, never played it.
You never played Double Dash? That's pretty much considered one of the best Mario Karts ever by a few people. I don't know, like, it's kind of hard for me to tell what's considered the best or worst, because there's so many online communities and groups of people.
I only ever played the Wii game. Didn't really care for it because I didn't have a Wii wheel that would fit my hands, because I got big hands.
I didn't really play with it with the Wii wheel. But, I enjoyed that. I don't think I ever 100%ed it, though, because I beat all the regular stuff, but once it got to the mirror mode, I'm sure you're aware of mirror mode, right?
Where the controls are reversed?
No, it's where the levels are reversed.
Oh, yeah.
As far as Mario Kart goes, once you beat it at the highest difficulty, you unlock mirror mode, which you play as the highest difficulty, except for that everything is reversed as far as the level layout goes.
Sort of like an F-Zero X where you beat it, you 100% it, then it unlocks X mode.
Oh.
That's randomly generated track.
Speaking about older stuff, I don't know, one of the things that I enjoyed playing that was never at all like a huge hit was Kirby's Air Ride, I think is it is. Did
Kirby's
you ever
Air Ride. I've actually, you heard of that? Is that the one where they, it's a list of one of the best, it's on this list of about 117 million in worldwide.
I didn't know that.
It's American Kirby's Hardcore.
Yeah.
It was the first, GameCube title support LAN play.
Did you ever run into anybody that used LAN GameCube? I assume you wouldn't. I never did because of probably the area I lived in.
No.
And plus, those modems were, like, alive.
Yeah.
I really wish I would have got one of those broadband modems back then, because they're really hard to get.
I kind of wanted to get one so that I could try and play Melee online, but
yeah, with mods and stuff, and network play.
Yeah, because, I mean, that was really cool, but
If you play Kirby's Air Ride now, you realize that also since it was HAL that made it, like, I feel like it was really a lot of them testing out stuff on the GameCube, because if you look at all the textures and stuff, not most of them are really refined, and there's a lot of things in there that are obviously, like, I swear are testing the GameCube's, like, ability to render stuff, or just play around with stuff. So if you want to have, like, an earlier sense of GameCube testing, I guess go for that.
Cool. let's see here. Legend of Zelda The Wind Waker. I beat that game a while ago.
I beat that game also. That was one of my favorite Zelda games, I think, of all time.
Oh,
and
yeah.
I really want the HD one to come out, even though I can't afford it at the moment.
Same here. I mean, I don't even have a Wii U. It's a sad thing that they ruined the American cover art, though.
Yeah, well, it's all the HD hardcore version, right?
Yeah. Because I still got the GameCube version, I played it all the way through, then I played the Special Quest a little bit, then I stopped when I got Skyward Sword. Hmm. Yeah. Yeah, that was an epic game. I loved the sailing, I loved the graphics, the combat, and everything.
Everything was pretty much, like, I thought that was an amazing game when I played it, and of course, so many people were just angry because, like, a lot of people, it happened yeah, there was not only that, but everybody, even now, does not understand what a tech demo is. Since if we go back, everybody knows about the Space World tech demo.
Yeah, the Space
World. They thought that was the new Zelda game.
Yeah. And I actually read about that in Nintendo Power. There was a huge backlash.
Yeah, it's because people don't know what tech demos are and can't accept the fact that the visual style wasn't realistic.
But then you got tech demos, those in quotation marks, of stuff like Aliens, Colonial Marines.
Yeah.
So yeah, I liked it. I stuck in the collector's edition, and after playing that one time, I mean, I was amazed at the difference between the graphics. Because I was on that, on Wind Waker for, like, months. Doing everything. And I was trying to get all the secrets and stuff because I had a guide for all the secrets.
I don't think I have 100% of that. And my original save file is on a memory card that I lost. So I don't think, I'm not sure if I ever will unless I get enough money to...
You can always action replay the stuff that you had.
Yeah, but still... And, I mean, I was going to do the HD version if I ever tried 100% it, because, you know, it's just I might as well do it with a nicer version. And then you know about the new update with the HD version, right?
Yeah, they got, they got a new, like, new suits for Link, and, like, they redid...
Oh, I was going to talk about, one of the features that I feel like is going to be the best part about the new one...
Mm-hmm.
Is the fact that they pretty much added a new upgrade, where since the GameCube can only draw so much, and now the Wii U is like two consoles ahead, it can draw like twice as far of the distance. So they're adding an upgrade where you can go twice as fast while sailing eventually.
That is...
So you can pretty much get rid of some tedium.
That sounds pretty cool. I mean, I actually kind of like the sailing, I think, because that made it... huge, but when I'm trying to, like, if I'm in a hurry to get somewhere, or if that actually sounds like it'd be kind of cool.
Yeah, that's pretty much good when you're in between certain parts.
Yeah.
Where, because, like, unless you're, like, looking around or just joyriding in that game, when you're trying to find, like, the Triforce pieces or do an exact thing, then it can get kind of tedious.
Yeah, finding the Triforce of Wisdom was the hardest part for me in that game. And then, of course, the water transparency, he was like, the water was transparent in Ocarina of Time and Majora's Mask, but it wasn't in Wind Waker, and then it was again in Skyward Sword and Twilight Princess. So I'm hoping they add some cel-shaded water transparency and, like, some cool stuff down at the bottom as well.
Yeah, I don't know if they will do that, because... Now, part of the thing was, like, there was treasures under there that you couldn't really see. If they do it mildly, maybe, because I don't want them to go, like, full-on with it.
Definitely. Hey, because if it's too clear, it'll,
That alters, like, the...
That alters the entire gameplay, hey, thing. We just mentioned, already talked about it, Animal Crossing. This was originally an N64 game.
Yeah, not many people know that.
Yeah, Yeah, good thing for Nintendo Power, right?
Yeah, pretty much.
Animal Crossing, can interact. It required a special memory card, didn't it?
The Animal Crossing?
Animal Crossing, yeah.
No, no, it just required a lot of space.
Huh.
It came with a memory card, I recall, with just like a sticker or something, but no, it does not.
I didn't know that it was also on the N64. It was on the GameCube and the N64.
Yeah, it was on the N64.
In Japan.
The GameCube what?
It was originally on the N64 in Japan, and it was ported to the GameCube internationally.
Yeah, pretty much. Well, they fixed that. I'm pretty sure they released the... Yeah, there's some slight differences. Also, what's weird is, even though it's a Japanese game on the N64, from what I've seen of it online and also seen from ROM dumps, is it's in English.
Oh, yeah.
Mostly.
There was this game. I've got a game... a Japanese Sonic Collection for the PS2. The PS2 version was only ever released in Japan, and that's all in English. Then you've got...
It's kind of odd when stuff like that happens.
Yeah, you've got the Death Note trilogy for the DS, and that's, like, the titles are all in English, and in fact some of the GUI is in English.
Yeah. I think we can just say GUI. For anybody that doesn't know, they're GUI or GUI, as
graphical
it's pronounced.
Graphical user interface.
It's a term for like the actual visuals you see in like computers and technology use and stuff, not the actual like hardcore like program stuff running. It's what people see. So,
wait, IQ player.
Oh, the IQ
Crossing
player.
Was ported to the IQ player. Isn't that just a GameCube?
No, that's not a GameCube. That's something different. That's the N64 in China, pretty much. We can talk about that later some other time.
Sorry, I'm getting that mixed up with, Oh, God, it's got a better joystick and D-pad.
The Hori controller? No?
No, the IQ player.
Oh. Yeah.
Mario Party 4. I played one Mario Party game. I can't remember what the name was.
I was burnt out of Mario Party by the end of the N64, so I never really played that.
I played one of them, and it had Snow and Princess Peach and Bowser, and it was on the GameCube.
That's one of three titles. I'm pretty sure four, five, and six, I'm pretty sure, came out on the GameCube.
Yeah.
Hold on, let me look it up.
They're all listed here as best sellers. Pokemon Colosseum.
I did not really play that. I believe that's the one with the dark Pokemon, is it?
No, that's XD Gale of Darkness.
Okay.
Which is that also one. On this list.
Yeah, Mario Party 7 was also on it, and then I'm also getting inappropriate Google images.
Ooh.
So, okay. Gary's mod can be terrible at sometimes.
Yeah. Pokemon Colosseum, an RPG developed by Genius Sonority.
Are you sure that Colosseum wasn't... It wasn't the same family as XD, I think. There was dark Pokemon and stuff, and there was all that stuff. I was just, like, disappointed because it led itself for me to believe that it was going to be, like, a...
A sequel?
No, like, more like the handheld Pokemon games, but, like, on a console. So I was, like... But then there's all this stuff about dark Pokemon, and it's not really open world, and I was just disappointed.
Yeah, we can talk about that next episode, I guess.
Yeah. Let's see. Metroid Prime, you can't really skip that. Did you play that?
Unfortunately not. I want to get a hold of all three games, because, like, I played Other M. I kind of liked Other M.
Well, Prime's a different beast, so...
Yeah, it looks like it has a better first-person mode, because I played Prime Hunters on the DS, and that was good.
Yeah, that was... The Hunters pretty much was as good as I think they could get on the DS, as far as a first-person shooter at that time.
Yeah, nice graphics, too. Better than GoldenEye and Call of Duty World at War were.
I didn't even really bother much with those.
And for that matter, Modern Warfare 3.
Oh, yeah. I can't believe that they even bothered with... I mean, I'm sure they spent barely anything developing those.
Yeah.
And they're gonna make back all the money they are from parents not understanding and just buying it for their kids.
Mm-hmm. Because it's cheaper than the Xbox 360 version, and blah blah blah. It didn't even. It was like. It had the first part of Modern Warfare 2 at the beginning. And now that I think of it, Paper Mario Thousand Year Door. Never played it. Never played the original Paper Mario. I played Super Paper Mario. I didn't exactly like it.
I never really played Mario RPG, which some people consider Paper Mario kind of a successor, but not really, because that's a Square game. But anyway, Paper Mario N64, I remember beating most of that, and I had actually rented it, so it ended up, I enjoyed it a lot, and then that came out, and I'm like, I'm definitely getting this. So I played through that. I'm pretty sure I beat the main story, and then after you beat the main story, there's not like New Game Plus or anything, but there's extra like side quests and stuff you can do afterwards, which I thought was a really good touch right there.
Oh, there was a release lawsuit known tentatively as Mario Story 2 in Japan. What?
Also, if you see on this list, they don't have any info on like PAL regions or anything.
No, they do not, but
Yeah, if anybody out
that's weird.
there knows anything about the PAL stuff, I'm sorry, we don't know anything. We're from the US region, so the best we know about really is US and Canada, and probably some about Japan. I definitely probably know more about the Japanese GameCube experience than the PAL region, even though that I don't speak Japanese, and most PAL regions are English or other Euro languages or Latin-based.
Ooh, Resident Evil 4. I
Yeah.
never played the P the GameCube version. I played the PS2 version. I love the PS2 version.
Basically, Capcom was like staking really with the GameCube. I feel like Capcom did a good job at supporting the GameCube throughout its lifetime, but then like since the GameCube wasn't that great, they eventually did port that. But if you still pay attention, like what really sucks is that the GameCube version looked the best of Resident Evil 4.
What about the Wii version?
The Wii version, I can't recall really, but
Because I remember the Wii version of the Resident Evil remake, which is a remake of the first Resident Evil, if you don't know that, had a sort of like it was patched for widescreen, so everything, so there were black borders on the sides of the screen, and that was just like, oh God, I've got a 4.8 TV in case. Just for just to put this in perspective, and gigantic black borders at the side, everything is smushed in to the middle, and it's just like it was kind of off,
Yeah.
like the entire thing was. I liked the new controls, but it wasn't like what would have really been cool would be if they'd have fixed the controls.
Yeah, I didn't really. I stuck pretty much with the GameCube one, and I'm pretty sure I did everything I could except for in the like highest difficulty on Resident Evil 4 for the GameCube, because of course it was hard mode, so it was way harder. But that's the only thing I didn't do besides, yeah, that was the one of the best looking games of the time. I think it's funny because like if you compare that to like Halo 2 now, unless you're if you're like a fanboy or something to Microsoft or Xbox, of course you'll probably have issues, but if you're looking at it from like a regular perspective, Halo 2 looked just god awful, the cutscenes loaded like crap, and like Resident Evil 4 was just really crisp and everything was nice.
The one thing that annoyed me about Resident Evil 4 was some of the quick time events. Like,
Yeah.
I didn't.
I had no problems with
I
that.
like them. I like the idea of them. But it just the fact that you have to go through the entire cutscene again, and if you miss one of the quick time events.
Yeah, well, that's not that bad.
No, but you.
I know there's probably people out there that disagree, so.
Sometimes you gotta. You just, it's just on the third, fourth, fifth time I'm going through there. Here you.
Yeah. Let's see. Mario Party 5, I think we could say about the same amount.
Sonic Mega Collection, that was Sonic 1, 2, 3, and Knuckles. Sonic
Yeah.
Jam.
Yeah, I played some of that. The
Not
copy I
jammed.
got would look like someone threw it through a toilet. It was
Oh.
pre-owned. I had played most of those games on the Genesis,
Yeah, me too. I've. Yeah. Go ahead.
Except for that, I don't think I ever played, when I was younger, Dr. Robotnik's Mean Bean Machine at all.
Yeah. Before I got the Mega Collection, and I had Sonic the Hedgehog 2, I played that, I beat that, and on my computer before I got my Genesis, I got Sonic the Hedgehog, another copy of Sonic 2, Sonic and Knuckles, and I played all those, I beat all those. I only really got it for Sonic 3D Blast, Sonic 3, Dr. Robotnik's Mean Bean Machine, and what was the other game? Named Sonic Spinball.
Yeah, I just wanted to get it because it was Sonic Collection.
Oh yeah,
and I like the GameCube, so
yeah.
I guess there's not much we can talk about that's GameCube specific because they're just pretty much emulated ROMs.
Yeah,
ported
sort of,
on.
Yeah, just like Sonic Adventure, where they had the game. The Game Gear ROMs for that?
Yeah.
Yeah.
That wasn't the DX version, so...
I played the DX version.
I think we
version.
Should talk of... Well, that's the GameCube version, is the DX.
Yeah. So, in Sonic Adventure DX, you got unlockable Game Gear games.
Yeah.
Would have been a whole lot better if they'd have had unlockable Genesis games in there. Because me, personally, I don't like the Game Gear ones.
Yeah. They were, I guess they were good at their times. They're kind of a Master System
yeah.
ROMs in a way, I guess.
Yeah.
Because the Game Gear and the Master System were pretty much the same thing, if you don't know.
Yeah. I actually looked that up. The only difference is really that
the was
Master
the color
System,
amount.
Yeah, the color amount in the Master System had large cartridges.
There was actually an adapter, I think, that you could play Master System games on a Game Gear.
And vice versa, probably.
No, they didn't make one vice versa, really, officially at all, ever, because the Master System had less colors, so that's where they had the issues.
Oh. Because
yeah.
I thought that because the Game Gear versions of Sonic 2, who's Sonic 1 and... I thought because they had those really a really bad color palette for the Game Gear versions on DX that the Master System versions would be better.
Hmm. I'm not sure.
Because I played
Oh, Kirby Air Ride was on this list.
Yeah, Kirby Air Ride's on this list.
The top sellers. I just
yeah. Resident Evil. This is a great game.
Yeah.
But
I like how yeah Resident Evil Zero also.
Resident Evil Zero. Great
we
game.
We talked about them. I never really... I barely played the remake Resident Evil that we just mentioned, so... I need to get around to that. I guess there's a few games on here that we really haven't played.
Yeah. I played the one... I played a game... and I got a copy from Hollywood Video. Oh. There's this guy...
I own a copy.
They got a copy from Hollywood Video. Oh, I bought that. I didn't realize that it had the Hollywood Video label on it, but...
I hate those.
Yeah.
Especially if you have any collectors or you just want to get them off because those places are gone.
It wasn't even a label, it was just a, it was a Hollywood Video, art, replacing yeah. the actual box art.
Yeah.
Legend of Zelda Twilight Princess, I have this for the Wii, paid $7 for it off of Craigslist.
I've never owned it, I've only started it a little bit, but I haven't got to it because, I don't know, I just haven't, and now GameCube games are... pretty much phased out, I think, at GameStop. If not, then I probably will check when like everything's getting
some of them have them, some of them don't.
Yeah,
like
they're
one...
pretty much being phased out.
Yeah. Like the last time I was at the local, in quotes, it's in the next town, on GameStop, they had PS2 games there, but PS2 and Xbox games there, no GameCube games for some reason. But then a while before that, they said, hey, we don't have PS2 games here when I was looking for a copy of Agent Under Fire.
Yeah.
Yeah, so Twilight Princess. Played
yeah.
the Wii version. I like it. I got stuck on it. I haven't gotten back to it in years.
That thing was one of the most, I don't know, like, because I can't recall much before, but one of the most delayed and anticipated Zelda games, I think, ever.
It was delayed an entire year.
It was delayed over a year, I think. In fact, it was delayed so much that they made the Wii port, pretty much, just to make up for it.
Well,
everybody wanted it because it looked like how they thought a Zelda game should look instead of cartoony. And then now I feel like more people prefer Wind Waker than it, but I haven't really played it fully, so I guess I can't fully judge it.
I, like I said, I played the Wii version. The Wii version was released in 2006. The GameCube version was released... Well, the Wii version was released in November of 2006. The GameCube version was released in December of 2006, a month after, and a release version from Nintendo Selects was released in 11. And like, I thought that, like, at one time when they said that the GameCube version was pushed back to the end of the year so that Nintendo could get the Wii out, but
I don't think that's not probably the real reasons.
But then some people say that both versions are pushed back to the end of 06 so that Nintendo can have the Wii out and that the Wii version can sell more and stuff.
Yeah.
And who knows?
Yeah.
Really. Like I said, I've got the original 06 Wii version. And I really like it. I didn't get back to it. I haven't gotten back to it in a couple of years because I don't know why.
Yeah.
I just got stuck on it.
Back to it. Let's see, there's that other Pokemon game.
Pokemon and XD Gale of Darkness. I was actually going to get this
really
game
played.
At one time, but I didn't.
I never played it, so I guess we don't have much to talk about it.
Yeah,
there's
modified.
The Mario Sports games.
Yeah. Mario Golf, never played it. Mario Strikers, never played it. Pikmin, never played it, want to.
I have played it. I never beat it, though, because I never owned a copy, for one. And two, like, pretty much they had the issue where you had to go and get pretty much all the main parts within the 30-day limit. And I never got around to really doing that.
What?
Yeah, pretty much you have to, in the in-game 30 days, you have to collect all the parts of the ship, except for the bonus part, or else you lose, so.
Don't tell me. All days in the game are about 13 minutes. That's not, you can't do that.
Yeah, you can.
Well, you can.
The average person can't, really. I guess the average kid probably wouldn't.
Yeah. Speaking of that, I actually had to... Like, I started off the original Resident Evil on normal difficulty. I had to restart the game because I couldn't hack it. And on normal, I had to bump it down to easy so that I could finish the game.
Oh, look, Star Fox Adventures is on this list.
Mm-hmm. Soul Calibur 2 as well. Well, it's surprising that a fighting game on the GameCube would sell well, because...
Yeah, I think... I'm sure there's some people that disagree, but that was my favorite version of Soul Calibur 2, because it ran just as good as all the other versions, and it had Link as the extra character.
Yeah. I tend to like to change between the joystick and the D-pad, and depending on what I want from movement, but... I have a third-party GameStop controller that I use on my PC, and it has a better D-pad than the GameCube, as far as I'm concerned, for, like, movement and stuff.
I mean, I can't think of many fighting games on the GameCube that weren't ports or on other systems. I don't really think I can't think of one, really. Can you think that was any exclusive fighting games on the GameCube?
No. No, I know that there were a couple of Mortal Kombat games on the GameCube.
Yeah, but they were not exclusive.
But they weren't exclusive. Was there a Street Fighter game on the GameCube? Or
There was, one of my favorite fighting games is Capcom versus SNK2 EO.
Oh yeah,
and
I've got
it was
that
a
for
cross
the
of those
PS2.
two. Yeah. Let's see. I think we pretty much we went over this list about. We've talked about Star Fox Adventures a little bit. Mario Party 6, pretty much the same as the other ones, I guess you'd say.
Yeah. Aren't they already out to like Mario Party 9?
Yeah. Pretty much. I don't know if we want to go too long into listing all the Nintendo Selects. Oh, the one we've missed though is the of the top games is Sonic Adventure 2 Battle.
Sonic Adventure 2 Battle. I haven't.
I
played it.
Started playing the Dreamcast version.
I've played it in the past. I need to play it now because I finished Sonic Adventure, or I need to play it again.
Now you can get it on Steam or 360 or PSN, I believe. Or not that much. There's
really
a lot of arguments on how good or decent those ports are.
Well, they also remove all the Sonic X branding and Soap Shoes branding from the game, though.
Yeah. There's a few other. For some reason, the GameCube version, one of the weirdest things that they did was they edited out Big the Cat in the background. If you can see him in the background of several stages,
mm-hmm.
and they edited him out completely of the GameCube version for I have no apparent idea.
Hmm. Yeah, that doesn't. I don't get that.
They also put in a few of the DLC for the Dreamcast version in this because, of course, the GameCube internet was terrible.
So was the PS2's.
Yeah. Well, no, it's not as bad as the GameCube.
Well,
trust
no.
me.
Well, no, it wasn't, but the PS2 didn't even. The PS2 liked the Dreamcast, and GameCube didn't come with its network adapter.
Yeah, any network adapter. I think once we finish talking about Sonic Adventure 2, we should segue either into the adapter accessories or the Dreamcast ports. Or
let's talk about the keyboard for the GameCube. That was
a keyboard?
Yeah, there was this keyboard for the GameCube. That was a WaveBird controller.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, it
I
had
forgot
um
about that.
It had a full-on QWERTY keyboard, the,
Oh, that thing. The ASCII 2 keyboard.
Yeah, ASCII did a whole lot of, strange accessories for consoles.
They've done a lot of strange accessories. I believe,
yeah.
I don't know if they still do. I can't think of any times that they, have in recent generations.
Yeah, because I've got a PSX pad that they did. It is angular, it is strange,
I have an ASCII
yeah.
Super Nintendo arcade stick controller, which is interesting. The DK drums.
Oh, the Donkey Bongas.
Yeah.
Yeah,
forgot
those,
about those.
Those were like, weren't those was really hard to use.
Probably. I suck at like rhythm games, so it's kind of blurry for me. I played a demo of it. That's about it.
Yeah, I heard that they were like unresponsive a while ago.
I can't recall. I wonder. Those are probably not too hard to get a hold of, I assume, because not too many people kept them or wanted them.
Well, then again, if not too many people wanted them, then that means that they probably didn't make too many.
Manufacture much, but
yeah. So that whoa, okay. Hey, the ASCII keyboard controller resembles a standard GameCube controller pad stretched to accommodate an alphanumeric keyboard in the center. Keyboard uses two controller boards and has not only the Latin alphabet, which is used everywhere, or that speaks English and other Latin languages, but also hiragana.
So the Japanese
characters.
Yeah.
Used for Phantasy Star, her online
oh,
episode
one of the
one
only
two.
Two online games on the GameCube.
Mm-hmm. but it's difficult, though not impossible, to acquire outside of Japan. This right here...
Also, that one was another Dreamcast port.
Yeah, this thing they got right here isn't even a real picture of it. They used to have a real picture, but now it's just a render.
Yeah.
Hori Game Boy Player controller was designed...
Hori is pretty much considered one of the best people for making third-party Nintendo controllers.
Yeah, definitely. I got some screen protectors from them for my 3DS. They are awesome. One of them's a little too... the lower one is a little too small, but it went on perfectly fine, and it's barely there.
Yeah.
So, anyways, the controller... Who was the shape of a Super Nintendo pad. No C-stick or control stick. L and R buttons are digital. And therefore... Yeah, it's only useful for Metal Gear, which was a pack-in. And they came with the Japanese version of Metal Gear Solid 2. Metal Gear Solid, the Twin Snakes, came with a VR missions disc.
How come we didn't get a VR mission disc?
They didn't even have the VR missions on the actual disc. The original... And the first two Metal Gear games. This was before Metal Gear Solid 3
came. Yeah, that... I was annoyed that we never got that.
Yeah, the game was rushed to completion. And because they had the actual game done, but they weren't able to make the...
Yeah, that was an interesting thing, I think. Because did you ever play Eternal Darkness? That's another... Nintendo GameCube exclusive that I played it, and it's interesting. I'm not sure how good everybody would consider it after like this much time's passed, but
Eternal Darkness Sanity's Rec Room is having a new game made in the series.
Oh, yeah, I heard about
by
that
by Shinji Mikami, mastermind behind the Resident Evil games, and I'm looking forward to that a little bit.
Yeah.
Logitech Speed Force Racing Wheel was made for Need for Speed, Burnout 2, Mario Kart Double Dash, F-Zero GX. Optional accessory pack includes foot pedals. Why would it not have foot pedals as the part of the regular pack? Because I've got
I'm looking at I forgot about the microphone attachment for the GameCube because it was used on like three things. I don't even know if it was used in Japan for more. But Mario Party 6, Mario Party 7, Karaoke Revolution, of course, and that Odama, which was a game that was a pinball game and a strategy game where you told the troops commands with it, and then they pretty much moved around while you were playing pinball on the battlefield.
Huh. Funny. Composite video cable. You know, Nintendo kept the same composite video cable
forever
from the Super Nintendo up until the GameCube, and it's really kind of sad that they didn't use the same
for the Wii. That irritated me.
Because then I could use cables, whatever cables with it, really.
Yeah.
S-Video cables.
S-Video, pretty much.
Yeah, S-Video.
Those are just different formats. The GameCube could do 3D, did you know that?
Yeah, Luigi's Mansion was capable of it. There was actually a 3D monitor for it, a stereoscopic. Yeah.
It's just the actual output... They never made anything for the GameCube to output 3D, so you can't really do it unless you're emulating it. So, let's see. Of course, there was Action Replay and stuff.
Yeah. D-terminal cable.
I can't think of many unofficial add-ons that were amazing.
Game Boy Player.
Yeah, the Game Boy Player, that's the official one, though. That was probably one of the best things, because it pretty much made a Game Boy Advance on your GameCube.
Yeah, it lets you play... I've actually encountered some problems with it. I put Pokemon Red in, and it got stuck in a constant reset loop.
Yeah, there's a few small issues, but...
Yeah. It took me a couple of years to track down one of those startup discs.
Yeah, those...
That's the annoying thing, is because people, they don't take care of both equally.
Right.
Because I think I have a broken startup disk. Let's see. There's the broadband modem, yeah, which we talked about the broadband modem a little bit.
They actually had a dial-up modem, too.
Yeah, I know, but that pretty much is pointless. Well, not only because of no servers, but as far as modding or hacking or ripping games or anything that you want to use a GameCube for, or LANing, you pretty much need the broadband thing, because
right,
there's nothing that really uses dial-up anymore.
No, well, dial-up was being phased out back then, too. Oh, SD card adapter. You could use, it was an official accessory, by the way.
Huh. Animal
only
card.
Sold in Japan,
Animal
though.
Crossing.
But I remember Nintendo Power advertised that as being a way to have larger memory cards, and you could transfer stuff back and forth.
I don't remember that ever. I don't know in Japan at all if they use that, but as far as here, I pretty much never.
Yeah, the third-party ones are pretty much nowadays just used for...
I want to get a hold of those, maybe, but I don't think that's going to be easy.
Yeah. They're pretty much just used for, so that you don't have to completely replace the disk drive if you want to use an SD card adapter.
Yeah. The Game Boy Advance cable.
The Max Drive. It lets
Max
you.
Drive?
Yeah, it's it lets
that's
you.
That's one of the Detel / Action Replay / Game Shark related material. Right.
Yeah, I've got a Mad Catz memory card that's like 2,000 blocks of data.
I think it was odd that they quit saying Game Shark and used Action Replay for once for that system. Like since then, they've used Action Replay instead of Game Shark, which
yeah,
is weird.
Oh, PlayStation 2 controller adapters.
Yeah, but anyway, you know that Action Replay is pretty much what a Game Shark is, but for some reason when it came to the US from Europe, they changed the name to Game Shark or something? I'm not sure why.
What about Game Genie? Game 2, I mean...
Yeah, those...
I only ever
those
heard of
phased
that
out by then. So,
the Game Genie was only ever on... NES. So you got the LCD screens. I've heard a lot of bad things about the Mad Catz and Intech, and specifically the Zenith LCD screens, because they're supposedly really bad.
No, I never had enough money for an LCD screen back then, so I don't even think I have one now, so...
Now, why would you even need one, though? Oh, I'm not going to be playing it in the car.
Yeah.
And now we move on onto them. So the GameCube games that have 480p and 16:9 support. Well, this is an entire list, right? This is lists longer than my R. Oh, True Crime Streets of Los Angeles. It's Grand Theft Auto. Oh, as a cop. That game is pretty cool.
That wasn't terrible. I thought that was possibly going to be terrible because, you know, it came out around the time that it could have been just a clone.
Yeah.
I'm not sure how good it stands up today because I haven't played it since back then, but I beat pretty much the main story. I don't remember if I 100%ed or anything.
I played one Grand Theft Auto game, that's Chinatown Wars. I loved it. And I haven't played San Andreas, Vice City 4, or 3.
I've played
3 yet.
Yeah, that's another thing the GameCube missed out on.
Yeah, because I got the first two Grand Theft Auto games for PC from Rockstar's promo stuff, but I don't have that. I actually really, like, the only... I got my driving game controls from Need for Speed, so I use the right analog stick, but I also like to have first-person view, and the thing is, the PS2 version always defaults to third-person in view, so I don't know, is that, like... Does Grand Theft Auto have the same problem that it doesn't automatically go to POV?
I'm not sure.
Got a whole bunch of Splinter Cell games.
Yeah, that was one of the good things, is that Ubisoft pretty much had those.
Yeah. I played the original whole Splinter Cell on the Xbox. I didn't particularly care for it. This was right after I played the first Metal Gear Solid.
He bleeds to mod their systems, I believe.
Yeah, I played MGS2 and MGS before I played the Splinter Cell, and
yeah,
it's just like
I played Metal Gear definitely before that. So I know there's a lot of people at the time being like, "Dude, this got fucking Whoop Salt Snake's ass and stuff."
Solid Snake is a genetically engineered super soldier.
Yeah,
or Sam Fisher is just some guy.
Also, Solid Snake, I feel like, has held up a lot better over the years, even though it's his dad now, but...
Well, hell, it's back to him for the latest game you play. He threw, Metal Gear Solid 5. I was, gonna have the beginning of the first Metal Gear in it, and you're probably gonna be playing a Snake in that. And after that, they're probably going to have 3D remakes of the original first two Metal Gear games.
Yeah, I'm not sure about that.
Prince of Persia.
I never really played much of the Prince of Persia games myself. There's a lot of games that I never really...
Yeah,
I've heard... ...really good at the time or still stand up for the GameCube that I never really got around to.
I heard good things about the Sands of Time trilogy. I've only ever played the, reboot on the Xbox 360. I kind of like that. It's not perfect, but I'll get around to this if I can. Need for Speed Underground. I played that on the PS2. Didn't particularly care for it.
I like number two a lot. I feel like Need for Speed games were a lot better back then.
Most Wanted is my favorite, and I played Undercover 2, and I like that. Metal Gear Solid Twin Snakes. Remake of Metal Gear Solid with Metal Gear Solid 2
in a way.
Trolls.
Engine. I like how there was the fact that there was a Mario in there that you could shoot at to get health. Or is that the Yoshi?
I haven't played it. I need to. I'm going to action replay a save onto it because I beat the original. I want to use bandana mode on...
the main thing.
On the main game of Twin Snakes, then I'm gonna play Tuxedo Mode in the PC version.
Oh, you mean the PC port?
Mm-hmm.
That's basically a Metal Gear Solid integral in English, if I recall correctly. That's another kind of rare thing. A lot of PC ports from those games now are like super rare and never re-released and stuff.
Well, which... And that's a strange thing because it's a good game.
Yeah, the closest game of that is like a PC port to be re-released is like the Final Fantasy VII port. Mm. The redone port.
Which was still... released. Whole didn't have... the graphics were...
Because there's so much nerd rage on the internet over that re-release that came out last year.
Yeah, the original graphics on the PlayStation weren't as good as Squaresoft liked to advertise.
Yeah.
The texturing was like cell shading.
Yeah, that stuff. Game does not except for nostalgia reasons.
It didn't age well.
Yeah, nostalgia's one of the main reasons anybody cares about the visuals of that game, I think.
Well, even for then, and you got games like the first Resident Evil had better graphics than that. And then the PC versions both use MIDI files for the music.
They convert them over, and a lot of people are angry about that because the quality is not as good.
Mm-hmm.
So people complain about that for the PC version. Anyway, that's a little off subject.
That's off topic.
How far are we in right now? Do you know?
We're in about an hour.
An hour?
Yeah, this is a 2-hour video upload limit for YouTube. Yeah,
I think we should try to sum up some stuff so that way we don't make these draw on too long.
Yeah, that sounds good.
We got a bit covered, I think, of the GameCube.
Yeah, they lack of. Let's see here. You're in third place behind the competitors, even though what?
Yeah, we mentioned that.
The PS2 was less powerful than the GameCube and the Dreamcast. It was the least powerful console of that generation. It got some I love the PS2.
It's because they use DVDs. It's one of the biggest draws.
Yeah. But then the GameCube had games like, excuse me, Resident Evil, Resident Evil Zero, Resident Evil 4, 007, GoldenEye, Rogue Agent, and the, what was the, Metal Gear Solid, the Twin Snakes, games like that had two discs.
Yeah, that's because they were compact discs, though. They would, I kind of wish, oh, the Panasonic Q, which was only in Japan, it was a GameCube that could play DVDs as well.
Yeah.
Nintendo really needs to just make it so that way they can use more standard discs and also play media.
Well, they
media.
Cut down, like, they cut down on piracy, because the Dreamcast, you could just really, you just stick a CD in and burn it and play it. The PS2 is a screwdriver, is a couple of screwdrivers and a couple of off-the-shelf pieces away from being homebrew. All you need is a you don't really need a whole lot of stuff to deal with the modifying the Xbox. The GameCube is the one on that remains hard to mod to this day.
Yeah, pretty much.
Which is good for back then, but not so good for now when you're trying
but
to.
But it's pretty much it's end of the cycle. People that care for it or collect for it want to mess around with a whole bunch of extra ones
and play all the Japanese games and stuff.
Yeah, well, if you have an Action Replay, you can play all the Japanese games as far as it goes in North America. I don't know about how it is in PAL regions or I've like really little idea what it's like for PAL games in the GameCube era.
Yeah. That's kind of strange. Oh, listen to this right here. Reception and sales. Hardware design and quality. Yeah, relatively unexpected. Best controller design. And, lack of games resulted in a subpar launch, although... Well, let's see here.
Yeah,
retrospective. What was the
competitors
launch?
Didn't really
launch titles for the PS2. Let's see here, Final Fantasy X.
I think are we on the same page on that game? Where I haven't really played much of it, but as far as like the story and changes and stuff, I just felt like it was a step down in the Final Fantasy games.
I don't like it as much as I like Chrono Cross.
Yeah.
I like it. I really want to like it, but they didn't do the graphics. The graphics are not Metal Gear Solid 2 standards.
Yeah, Metal Gear Solid 2 was a good standard.
Right.
But Metal Gear on the GameCube was also a good visual standard, I think.
Yeah. Let's see here. Launch title was for the PS2. Does not... Let's see here. Launch. Okay. They don't have launch. They don't have launch stuff on here. History. Okay. Hey, they had fully playable demos. No, that doesn't count. Okay, quick Google here. PS2 launch titles. Xbox, of course, had Halo.
Is that even a launch title? I don't think it was.
Halo Combat Evolved, Dead or Alive 3, Oddworld, Munch's Odyssey, Project Gotham Racing. Does that have anything to do with Batman?
No.
Jet Set Radio Future.
That was the name you wanted.
Yeah, they got a whole bunch of stuff on here. Most of that I've never heard of. Okay, they've got Armored Core 2. Here are all the launch title lists. Armored Core 2, Dead or Alive 2, Hardcore, Dynasty Warriors 2, ESPN Track and Field, One ESPN X Games Snowboarding, Eternal Ring, Everblaze, Fanaville, Fanavision, Gun Griffin Blaze, Kessen, Hitman and NFL 01, Midnight Club, MotoGP, which was also released on the PlayStation. NHL 01, Orphan, and Cue Ball Billiards Master. Street Fighter EX 2, Silent Scope, Smuggler's Run, Tekken Tag Tournament.
Street Fighter love for the PS2 than there was on the GameCube, that's pretty apparent. Dreamcast got a lot more, but that's because they were actually making them still on, like, the arcades and stuff then.
Yeah. This is all, like... We're talking, like, Metal Gear Solid 2 couldn't have been on the GameCube because it lacked an L1
enough
button.
Space?
It lacked an L1 button.
Yeah.
They could have put it on, like, 2 or 3 discs, but because they couldn't... Because the joysticks didn't have buttons under them, and you didn't have an L1 button, and you pretty much couldn't have had a good port of that.
Yeah.
And considering the kind of thing they did with Metal Gear Solid 2 on the Xbox was, which remind me, was Metal Gear Solid 2 HD?
Metal Gear Solid 2 Xbox port had slowdowns and stuff.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
So, yeah, it didn't.
The Xbox 360 didn't have those slowdowns, but it seems like a straight port of the Xbox version.
I don't know. Well, it's not. There's been several versions of 2 now, I guess.
Yeah, the original
and
Substance.
What I hated about the HD version is they didn't include a document at all. And skateboarding.
Yeah, they didn't include the document and the skateboarding. So,
which, you think if they were gonna have an HD version, it'd be the definitive version of the game.
They might have put it, which considering the fact that they put that the Xbox 360 also got Devil May Cry HD Collection, which is all 3 Devil May Cry PS2 games on a single disc. Mm-hmm. You'd think that they. Plus a whole bunch of concept art and stuff. If they could have put that on there. So anyways, back to the GameCube. It lacked some key FPS games. Well, it had the first 2 Call of Duty games. It had...
Yeah, but they were not, like, the regular versions of the first 2 Call of Duty games.
Yeah.
They were... The console version of the first Call of Duty, which wasn't terrible at all.
They're sequels to the original, not actual ports.
No, they weren't ports. They were not quite sequels either. They were basically just the console versions. Mm-hmm. Well, except for Call of Duty 2, the 360 version, the PC version, were pretty much the same game, of course, besides the minor issues of how they ran and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And... what they got for the previous generation was a different game called Big Red One.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's what you're thinking of.
Yeah, I've got Finest Hour for the PS2. I kind of like it. It's too brown for my taste. I like the Modern Warfare games better.
Yeah.
So yeah, it didn't have the GameCube didn't have Grand Theft Auto, but it did have Simpsons Hit and Run, which was essentially Grand Theft Auto 3. It lacked several key FPSs. Like I said, Call of Duty... Finest Hour, Call of Duty, E2, Big Red One. It also had GoldenEye Rogue Agent and...
GoldenEye Rogue Agent I never really played, but from what I hear, it was kind of a letdown because they were just trying to milk...
Cash in on the big hit that was Activision.
...64, and then also James Bond dies in it or something, and you play a Rogue Agent and stuff.
You kill him.
Yeah.
So, yeah,
It was just kind of a weird thing. I think we should try to exit out here, so that way we can... I want to keep this kind of not too long.
Yeah, I gotta go for a walk soon.
So...
One last thing I need to say here. The PS2 version of Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone had a whole lot of slowdown. Whereas the GameCube version did not. Whenever you went into the sandbox mode for the PS2 version, it had slowdown, and that was a common complaint for the PS2.
I wonder if they developed it mainly on the GameCube and ported the PS2 version. That's a possibility.
That's entirely probable. Well, they did that with a lot of games, like Sonic Heroes and Shadow the Hedgehog, allegedly, he had issues like that.
I think we should also mention briefly that there was an arcade board that made by Sega also.
Yeah, that was,
I think Namco, that was based on the
Triforce.
Game. Yeah, the Triforce.
They used that for F-Zero AX.
If people don't know, if you can somehow get ROMs or ISOs or whatever of those games,
it can also be
if they use GD-ROMs, you can play them on Dolphin.
Cool. Well, yeah. Anyways, we gotta wrap this up here. It's getting
The GameCube, pretty much, I think we've covered a bit of it. It didn't do that good.
Lasted until like 2007. It was a good console. I liked it. I like it still.
I still own two GameCubes that are different models and colors.
Yeah, so. Same. So, anyways, we'll see you in the next episode.
Yeah, hopefully we'll get some kind of idea of the name of the episode. We'll try to get like a better structure. This is pretty much like the pilot episode, so.
Right. So, like and favorite if you enjoy. Please post in the comments below. Tell us what
please
we can improve.
Give negative criticism properly.
Right. Don't troll.
Don't
just
troll.
Of what I said about Final Fantasy
don't,
VII.
Don't instantly just be like, why are you guys to faggots, okay? Just actually put some
decent
things.
Comments.
And also, if you disagree with a few things, then try to be mild about that and not ignorant, or also don't debate us on actual facts.
Right, because we have researched this stuff.
We have mild research, and then you can't also tell us stuff like Xbox is number one, okay, thanks, bye, so.
Right. Well, I will see you later, Sam.
Okay, I'll see you later, Alex.